Kids change you, not just in stereotypical ways like going to bed early or having a house filled with colorful toys or listening to weird baby-friendly music. Those are choices that parents are making. No, none of those are the way that kids physiologically change you. Literally, they release chemicals that change our brains. It's so cool. Let's kick into it. Hey everyone, welcome to episode 3 of 4 on Dad Parents. So far, we've covered the benefits to kids, the equalness of same-sex parentage, and now, like the bakers in a showstopper,
bakers!
We are halfway through.
Can't be halfway!
You know, the phenomenon where babies' heads smell good is incredible because they really do smell good. We had a plumber come to the house and his wife was like, smell the baby when you're there. Cause it's just, they smell so good. Humans wanna smell babies' heads and it's weird. Don't go around smelling other people's heads. But scientists aren't sure why the baby head smells nice. They know that they release chemicals though. Their heads are manipulating you. Their heads release a chemical called hex, or hexadecanol. Hexadecanol is a human volatile chemical. Volatile means airborne. It's odorless, but we still sense it. The chemical is manipulating parents and affects sexes differently. We inhale it, and it changes us. They scanned the brains of the participants in this study, and they found that the affected parts of our brains were associated with fear, social cues, contexts, and aggression. Male aggression is actually lessened by the hex chemical, whereas female aggression is heightened. And the science literally came out like 2 weeks ago, so I haven't really gotten to dig into it too much, but it's amazing. And this is just one of the ways that kids manipulate their parents. Parents are literally different humans after they have children. And since I just had a kid, that means that my brain is different now than it ever has been before. When a kid falls asleep on your chest, or when you hold hands with your partner, when you're holding or playing with your pets, the little pituitary gland inside of our brains releases lots of hormones, and one of these is oxytocin. It literally changes your brain for the better. I mean, literally everything you do changes your brain, like all the time. Your brain is plastic and constantly updating itself, but you know, whatever. Oxytocin is sort of erroneously called the love hormone. It doesn't actually have anything to do with love as much as bonding. And it does a lot of other things, like any hormone. It is a kind of a key ring, more than just one key. And it changes all sorts of stuff around your body. And one of those is that it actually causes an increase in empathy and a change in your emotional alignment. These changes literally motivate men to care for their children. It also reduces testosterone levels. Whoa, whoa, men. Hey, it's fine. It isn't good or bad. Both men and women have testosterone all the time. Testosterone isn't like Scrooge's vault. You don't want to just have it be chock full so you can dive into a pool of it. And less testosterone, science think, may reduce risk-taking behaviors, which would make sense if you're gonna have a child. And so the kid encourages oxytocin in you and you encourage oxytocin back. Skin-to-skin contact is required for much of this interaction, except for that human volatile chemical stuff, which seems to just kind of come off the baby, messing with your brain. But the important thing here is all of this involves parents to be present, engaged, and involved. And again, this works for literally every type of parent and dad, biological, adoptive, heterosexual, or queer. Oxytocin was consistent across both men and women when studied, but caused different behaviors in each one. Amazing. It's an evolutionary benefit. In a case study where grandparents spat into a vial and measured levels of the bonding hormone oxytocin, grandmas would spike right away. As soon as they saw the baby, oh my God, oxytocin everywhere. Grandpas, though, would actually have a delay and spike later. That doesn't mean that it didn't spike. Both males and females respond to this hormone and have a spike. And the amount it spiked was the same. It was just the timing that was different. Dads and moms are forever changed by their infant in these ways. And this is especially true with your own infant. Men, Y'all are not less of a parent. You're the same of a parent. But there are literally almost 9 billion results on mom-baby bonding. The birther-birthy relationship has been so studied, so last century and before, but decades after discovering the link between mom and baby, some scientists pointed that brain flashlight dad's way, and surprise, surprise, baby interactions change dads too. What? Who would have ever thought that? Come on, everyone thought that. We're all 100% natural human, okay? Come on. Everybody's brain is a human brain. How OxyT changes dad brains is really important. Our brains are slightly different, and thus brain chemistry and reactions to stimuli and so on are different too, but we're all human, which means we all react to things. Men can even get postpartum depression. This chart shows brain changes in mom and dad brains. Both brains change. No brain is left the same after this experience. And this is especially true if you are present, engaged, and involved. The thing is, if you have a birthing parent and a non-birthing parent, do they experience similar changes? If you have two dads and neither one birthed the child, do they both have the brain changes to the dad brain on this chart? Or not. More research is needed, my friends, and there are behavioral differences involved as well. Something else, baby contact ups prolactin production. Whoa, man, hey, prolactin, it's fine, it's totally fine. I know it has lact in there, like lactate, but you're not gonna go all meet the fuckers on us out there, okay, I promise. Prolactin is an ancient hormone. It existed even before mammals existed, and if you know anything about mammals, you know that they're named that way because of the mammaries, so breastfeeding wasn't even a thing yet when prolactin evolved. So more prolactin in non-birthing partners is associated with learning exploration and play. And play is good. Play is the best. Just like with animals, play is a key way that we learn about our world. We learn how to use our body. We learn motor skills and social skills, when to stop and go. And play has rules, complex social cues, and coordination. Even unstructured play, just running around, helps kids understand their bodies and minds. Also, how the laws of the universe work for them, against them, and around them. I've been sort of dancing around this, no pun intended, this entire series so far, but I really want to dig into play because dads are strongly associated in the studies with play. Play is extremely important to all humans, and this is where the traits of being a dad really come into play. Again, no pun intended. We need to learn to play both mentally and physically, and we are taught that. That doesn't come inborn. Stereotypically, moms during play might say, "Be careful," while dads would say, "Go for it." And that's more of a continuum of cautious to risky. And maybe I'm stereotyping by saying moms would be careful and dads might say, "Go for it." Perhaps your parents are swapped there. And that is the point. Not all moms are safe. Not all dads are rough and tumble. Every family unit is different. And it's not about stereotypes. It's often situational, personal. And dads are just more associated with risky behavior. Acknowledging that all parents have their own personalities fits with the same-sex parentage of episode 2 and different sex parents and non-traditional gender roles, and it also fits with how we change our children from episode 1. It's always likely that two people are gonna have slightly different sets of values. They may not even know they're different until the situation comes up and you're on the sideline of your kid's soccer game and you're looking around and all of a sudden you hear, "Kill him!" And another mom's like, "What's up with Alicia?" And you're like, "Wow, that was aggressive, honey. I don't know. Maybe you don't have to kill him, son. Just do your best." Hearing just one of those cheers, "Kill him," that's fine. But both? Way better. That teaches the kid that the world isn't just one thing, that mom and dad aren't exactly the same. They're gonna give you options. They're gonna give you a continuum to play with. And I'm sort of going off on my own tangent here, but you get it. This teaches the kid regulation. And this stuff is complicated and really tough to study, but it's one of the reasons why play is so important. You're learning all of this stuff about the world. One quick note that's sort of a sidebar here. Communication from young girls to male figures, also important. Girls learn to tell male parents no, just like boys do. But I was talking to my friend, Dr. Ali Matu, and he pointed out that with girls, telling their parents no can help develop healthy relationships with refusal, consent, and body autonomy. When a young girl tells her dad, "No, I don't want that," that's a valuable lesson for the dad to respect. Because we live in a society that believes boys will be boys. I wish I didn't have to say it, but that is the reality. And so teaching women consent can start even when they're young, just by respecting their wishes. Okay, end sidebar there. Again, most studies indicate there is no causal difference between same-sex and different-sex parents, though some interesting correlations that you should ruminate on. And in the end, dads change. No matter what they do end up changing. They're more than just male parents. They're sources of play, security, safety, communication, emotion and empathy, love and companionship, just like any other parent. The benefit is that because they're non-birthing parents often, they have different outlooks than birthing parents, simply because they're different human beings. Some dads do birth, some moms don't. That's totally fine. The important thing is to remember, your brain is gonna change when you have a kid, and they're gonna change in different ways because you're a different person. The important thing is also to remember that those traits, the behaviors of being a mom or a dad, they're probably going to come out of you naturally, but if you know and recognize them, it's going to help you to fulfill whatever role it is in whatever moment that you're in that you want to fulfill. Because you don't have to just pick one and stick to it. There's nothing in the science that says all dads have to dad all the dad time. Ha! So come back next time to find out what happens if you pick that dad role and you go full stereotype. You go a little too hard in the dad role and you end up being too macho. What happens to your kid? Is it better or worse? Find out next time, and thanks for watching.